Welcome everybody to Woogie's Corner once again. Today we're going to have a good time with a story that's one of my favorites. And so we'll just jump right in. This is going to be the story of the House of the Rising Sun. Now when you hear that, what do you hear? Think of the House of the Rising Sun, that great big hit in 1964 with Eric Burton and the Animals. Now we all know the main version of the story, how it just became this monster hit. It was written about some kind of bordello down in New Orleans, and boy, I tell you, better beware because it'll get you and you're gonna fall into sin and disrepute and everything's going to be really bad and you're going to die a horrible death. Okay. Well, everybody had to go with this song. And anyway, for our purposes, let's go back. Let's just go back. It's rumored. 17th century is where some of the roots of this thing came up. Out of France, ended up in England. And they played around with some rudimentary elements of it. They used to call it, there were some early titles with the Rising Sun, the Rising Sun Blues. So anyway, we'll fast forward to the American shores in 1905. That's where in 1905, for various reasons, that's when this kind of chord structure started to emerge. And then we'll fast forward again in 1925. A guy named Robert Winslow actually patented and printed the lyrics for the song, which we know today as "There is a house in New Orleans. They call the rising sun." So it goes on from there. So over the next 30 years, different people had to go at it. Nina Simone, Vic Damone, Tommy Dorsey's orchestra, Andy Griffiths of all people. Oh man, most of your major singers of the day had to go with this thing. But nobody ever really started it with that, this. So let's move up to the story. This is where the story I want to get to. Oh, wait a minute. Before we get into that, folks, I got a brand new book out. Just came out last year. Rattlesnakes, Airplanes, and Gold. And this is a story of, well, Rattlesnakes, Airplanes, and Gold. It's an autobiography adventure, okay, about my early life, later life. It covers the years 1940s up into 1970. Anyway, it's a great read. I really hope you will buy it. I'm going to be working on a link thing to get a sales thing happening. We're just in the process of that now. But I just had to tell you about that. Okay, back to the story. Animals. This is the story that I really want to tell about this thing. Alan Price, who was the keyboard player for the Animals, Eric Burton and the Animals, and they had, I think, Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood and a few other stuff, and they were fairly getting known in England around that time. In fact, they were on tour opening for Chuck Berry. So they get into the studio with a famous producer, his name is Mickey Most back in those days, and they had about 4 days to get in the studio and get a whole bunch of stuff done for an upcoming album. So there they were in the studio, and while this was going on, Alan Price, who I mentioned earlier, he was a keyboard player for the Animals, and he was also a bit of a historian a jazz player, a ranger, a bit of a producer. He was known among some of the players. Well, he had been hunting around, going to music stores and, you know, keeping his ear to the ground. He was always looking for something that he could do. He came across this thing. It was out there, but nobody had ever really done much with it. So he takes it home and starts playing around with it. Let's see. He had a Vox Continental organ. Which I can't get that sound on this thing, but it's... But the basic thing is... starts messing around with it. Okay, so about day two or three into this recording session with this Mickey Most. Now, Mickey Most was a kind of a, well, as the word was, he was a taskmaster. He liked to get her done, right? He's under a budget constraints from the record company at the time, and let's get her done. We haven't got time to fool around. And anyway, he didn't like guys coming in with extra projects and doing, you know, getting sidetracked. They had a certain list of songs they were going to do, and bang, they're going to do them. So one day, about day two or three, the guy, Mickey and some of the boys, they go out to lunch. Okay. So it just happened to be that Eric and Alan Price and I think one or two of the other guys in the band stuck around. So, as soon as they get Mickey out the door, Alan says, "Hey, guys, gather around." He says, I got something I got to show. I got to show you this thing. So he starts. Anyway, they grab their instruments and they start playing around. Well, by the time Mickey comes back for lunch, they're excited. They had something. They never don't tell Mickey about this. He'll go ballistic if he hears about this. He don't like this kind of stuff going on. So anyway, so they said, tell you what, the assistant engineer was still there, and he said, tonight at around 9 o'clock, if we come back here, will you come back with us and we can record this thing? The guy said, yeah, hey man, I'm on it. We'll be here. So anyway, they finished the day's, their normal session. So that night, they all come cruising back into studio about 9 o'clock. And they did this thing, folks, in 15 minutes. Because they had done some of it during the day at lunch hour. But they didn't fool around, boy. They got on it. 15 minutes, they had it. So they, the next morning, this is kind of fun. Mickey walks in. And they're all in there. They're getting ready to start, day four or something. And he's looking around, and they're all sitting around with a kind of funny. He said, "What's going on, boys?" He said, "Well, they call him Sir." In those days, you know, I mean, he was the record company's man. I mean, you didn't want to mess with these guys. "Well, Sir, we got something here that we think you need to look at, take a listen to." "Well, what?" "Time's wasted. We got things to..." "No, you need to listen to this." So they threw on the tape. So now I'll tell you, this story is coming right from Alan Price. I'm not making this up. Alan Price was there. He's the guy that was sort of the spearhead in this whole thing. So anyway, they start playing this thing. Well, he said, "Well, Mickey, you know, he's sitting in his chair and he's listening to this. And as it's going on, he starts leaning back in the chair, and 4.5 minutes long, this thing, which is way longer than virtually every song out there. Because in those days, everything was a 2.5 minute song, basically." So He sits there in silence at the end of the tape ran out, and he just sits there. He turns to the assistant engineer and he says, "Run me off a copy of that," which would be on small reel-to-reel, I guess. He never said a word. He got up, he grabbed that copy of that reel-to-reel, and out the door he went. So the other guys, they didn't know whether they pissed him off or what. Well, what he did was, he wasn't a stupid man. He might have been a taskmaster, and he might be a hard ass, but he knew something when he heard it. off he went to the headquarters at EMI. I believe it was EMI they were working for. And he gets a hold of the A&R guy. And he said, sit down, you got to listen to this. So they listen to this thing. And they, holy crap, Mickey, we can't. This thing's 4.5 minutes long. He said, the radio stations are going to go nuts with it. Never mind, we need to do this. By golly, he stuck to his guns. And they did do a shortened up version for America that later on. Okay, but originally they said, no, we'll release it in its full format. But they agreed they should release it. Oh, just get it out because it's something here. So they did. They put her out there, and by golly, so they were on tour with Chuck Berry. They used to do it every night at the end of their set, right? And it used to, people used to go wild with this thing. They just love this thing. Chuck Berry wasn't too impressed because he didn't like being upstaged, let's face it. So anyway, let's see. Yeah, this thing just became a monster hit, and well, what can we say? It's one of those songs that has stuck with us all these years. And now you know the rest of the story. Okay. And as you also know, I like to do a little musical ditty at the end of these things. Well, I tell you what, there's only one choice to do here. And that's, we're going to do this thing. So, without any further ado, the great... Do a little bit of it anyway. The House of the Rising Sun. There is a house in New They call the rising sun, and it's been the ruin of many. I'm gone, I know why. Thank you all for coming and listening to this episode of Woogie's Corner, and we got more stories. I got a whole bunch of stuff I got to tell you coming up. See you next time.